The story started with me testing out the resistance of thousands of flexor actuators just to plot a fancy graph, and then realized that the majority are out of my datasheet specified range.
What the heck?
Do you remember when I launched Flexar last year and talked about how I'm going to have a chat with the PCB manufacturer to try and lower this tolerance down? Yeah, turns out that's not possible unless we match the impedance to 50, 90 or 100 ohms, which is definitely not okay for Flexar. So my goal for this video is to try and understand where this variation is coming from, and if there's anything with the design that we can do to improve it. Before I start this video, I would like to note that this part-to-part variation is common, especially with motors and coils. When you have two motors that are of the same exact model, their parameters are still going to be slightly different. And Flexar is the same, there's always going to be a variation. But I always thought that this variation would be smaller, because the coil is not wire wounded, but printed on a board. So let's kick this off with a brainstorming session and list all the things which I think could be affecting. If you're familiar with high-speed PCB design, you probably know that the impedance of a track depends on the width of the track, the copper thickness, dielectric constant, and the distance between the two layers. Now, Flexar is meant to operate at DC or low frequencies, so I don't think that the dielectric constant should affect us that much. I also think that if there's any variation in this distance here, it should affect the inductance rather than the resistance. I'm leaning more at blaming the copper width and thickness for this problem. Remember that the coil has a track width and pitch of 0.1 mm, and considering both layers, the track is longer than 1.8 meters, so it's definitely possible that there could be some variation with these two. There's also the scary possibility of there being some kind of micro hairline short between the tracks. I don't think this is the case, but I cannot know for sure unless I get my hands on some super expensive equipment. I headed to my former university to examine my PCBs using their X-ray inspection system. This machine is mainly used to analyze the quality of soldering joints and PCBs. It costs around 200k, and the last time I've used it was around 5 years ago, so I would like to thank Engineer Ruben De Bono for helping me with the following tests. Before we look at the coil results, I want to briefly show how this tool works. As an example, this is how an Arduino Uno looks like under the X-ray beam. As you can see, both the dielectric and solder must become invisible as they don't absorb the waves. So we can only see the copper layers, soldering joints and electronic components. If you zoom really close, you can also see what's inside the chip itself. I also examined my stepper PCB motor just for fun, and it looked so cool. What didn't look good was the soldering blobs and misaligned components. It was time to put the coils under the beam, and I started by analyzing two samples that were clearly damaged. One of them was open circuit, and after some searching, we managed to find the problem. The other one had a resistance of 13 ohms, and visually it was pretty clear that the coil had something weird.
Stai con il layer lì, fuori ora, vale per tracciare.
Io stai con lì, il Mac è stato sfellato, è stato sfellato, mi ha short quello che sfellato.
L'importante è che non può, no?
Una roba sfellata. C'era già un bettino, c'è da.
Ma se non dici che è sfellato, sì, ora.
Un bettino, non c'è, no? No.
Il dato ha guardato, no? Per il suo, però ha guardato il suo. Line qui.
E ha tutto.
Vedi. Tässä kan ci dicha ko per dire bene tu. Esso.
Ma tu stesse come una loca. Ma tu stesse dense tal tal tappa. C'è color differente.
Sto bene tu il qua. Il display.
Esso fatto ti fuse ma.
Forse o copere e ha fatto.
Esso
che 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 mo per me lo ma ha tu dur dora folla e sa forse ma da lì di che nella ultim sta.
What the heck is it? Però le erme non fiusi a sgù. Blood.
jisom jisom xaħar.
Ti dawart għasabtu? Ha? Dawart
għasabtu? Ti dawart. Il dawart il-tajgu maħx il dawart.
Maħx xan jilek xan jukar li maħm maħm tritti xo li xo uqtar. Normalment jisom dit tip ta' fusing bete jitfollok naħa stan.
Aha.
Jow flux, whatever. Ma da jisom stan. Maħx xan du xaqsan stan madaw. Kif taħalaw. Jow ija kolla jennaf. Kolla kondaktif. Xi forma ta' metalli bla din naqblu. Għax kieku ma tidirx. Ma l-istess density tal-lejer ta' taħt qiegħda jisim. Ta' trek sinta. Hawnhekk fejn hawn diskrepanza.
Ah, l-oqa tidher fake point, ħaw tidher biċċa jisom daħlu għal-ġewwa. Għalhekk x'taqbu, dak isek liġbil ma nafx sa dejx x'kienet.
Ma jiena li dawn huma xogħol.
Tisa tara viġbili jisa. Solder għas muxu għabbal sija.
Kifin, numma xort, ma xinu l-proċess kif produċu għam, ma nafx.
To confirm this analysis, I decided to cut the PCB in half and take a look at it under my microscope. I'm not sure how this happened, but clearly there's copper shorting the turns and also the two layers together. Now remember that I only found two damaged PCBs out of 2650, so the probability of occurrence is very low. The next thing I had to understand was the resistance variation. I selected the minimum, maximum and a couple of average resistance samples so that we can compare them under the X-ray. None of the coils had shorted turns and there was nothing obvious that you could spot until we started measuring the coil's pitch.
Spacing tow is on a harimic value.
Tabajnita, mo? Enke. Jekk immorru, meġer. Meġer. Għana hu blank over, għana rana. Għana għan telefon għal sultar il-mass. Għan kuna għazitek. Minem. Għan tuħ zir. Għan il-losek. Għan għan tuħ.
The minimum resistance had a pitch of 0.07 mm, while the maximum had a pitch of 0.15. We also put the maximum and minimum coil side by side to get a better visual comparison.
Rek junior neck, eżatt. Suppost naraw, we had kemxej, suppost tiktarusa in pitch, uddi għatrek.
Xinta romek ta' t-impression li da' u għaxen jider għan jidek jistaj kun imma jitin għarraq bija nis.
Lala, di xot t-der li jisu għaxen da'
jidru għaxen lew.
Aha. U għanka t-der għaxen trek u għar għisa.
Lala, varjanza fi trek zgur.
Now obviously we couldn't measure every turn of every coil, but the thickness is not constant. If we run a simulation assuming a long straight track with constant width, its resistance can vary between 12 to 34 ohms. This confirms that practically the pitch error has its own variation. Now if we go back to the board, you can say that the copper wet is the main suspect, but I cannot eliminate this one completely because I cannot think of a way to test the uniformity of 18 micrometer thick copper. Now unfortunately from a design perspective there is nothing we can do to lower this tolerance because it's purely a limitation of manufacturing. The only thing I could think of is making the tracks and pitch wider, but that will have other effects on the coil. So for now we have to accept this variation, but we also need to understand how this variation is affecting other parameters. To do this we need some new gear. The first thing I got was an LCR meter, which Keysight kindly sponsored. This meter has a 20,000 count resolution, 100 kHz test frequency and can also be zero calibrated. So I measured the maximum and minimum resistance samples again, which were now 23.38 and 16.55 ohms. I also measured the inductance of both coils and they varied between 28.67 and 28.81. The next thing I did was build this 3D printed magnetometer setup to measure the difference in magnetic flux density at different heights. This graph shows the two results and as you can see the 16 ohm coil has a stronger magnetic field, which makes sense given that it allows more current to pass through the windings. Okay, so let's stop for a second and talk about this problem, because I think it concerns all my PCB coil projects. Let's take my Flex Frog as an example. If two of these coils are 16 ohm and the other two are 23 ohm, there's going to be a drift when powering them with the same voltage, because these two will have a stronger magnetic field. Apart from that, we have part-to-part variation, so another frog could have coils with different resistance values. For other projects that I only use one coil, there will only be part-to-part variation. So when we want to drive multiple coils with the same strength or speed, we have to compensate for this manufacturing resistance error. This can be done by using a constant current driver. In the frog case, I think we can also use an IMU and instead compensate for the tilting error. The last thing I had to measure was the temperature. I heated both coils by powering them at different voltage levels and measured the temperature using a new thermal camera I got. This allowed me to read the maximum heat point of the board. As expected, the temperature difference between the two samples kept increasing, which at 5 volts reached to around 20 degrees Celsius. All these parameters and new variations are updated on the new datasheet revision. This basically concludes all the analysis. Before I end this video, I'd like to thank the electronics department of University of Malta for letting me use their X-ray inspection machine. When I was a student, I had the privilege to work and study in their awesome lab, which gave me exposure to some high-end engineering tools. I have linked some cool projects their students are working on, so if you're interested in that, go check that out. See you in the next video.